Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us here today. We're going to talk about benefit selection, and not just about selection, but utilization and actual outcomes, because that's what benefits are supposed to be for, although they're not always that way. It's great. We have a great panel here. I'm going to introduce you all briefly, and then we're going to kind of jump into questions about what you guys are doing and how you're looking at benefit selection. So we have George on the end from DEF Research. He's been studying the healthcare consumer for over 25 years. Spent the first 12 years at P&G's Healthcare Consumer Institute. While he was there, he studied healthcare consumer across all aspects of care delivery and used them to provide consultation to P&G's brand teams as well as many partner carriers. He's now doing that, bringing that to carriers at Deft. He's been there since 2010 and has worked with more than 130 different carriers. I didn't know there were that many carriers, George, so that's impressive, to help them better understand the modern healthcare consumer. Next to George, we have Carrie. Dr. Carrie Meyer, Director of Clinical Programs at Amplifon Hearing Healthcare. She's a clinical audiologist with over 30 years of experience in diagnostic assessment of hearing loss, tinnitus, and balance dysfunction, as well as hearing aid evaluation, fitting, and verification. In her role as director of clinical programs, she worked with providers, health plans, and members to optimize hearing health outcomes by improving clinical care pathways. She successfully led her team through the accreditation process, and Amplifon Hearing Healthcare was granted full accreditation for health utilization management by the Utilization Review Accreditation Committee. You're just trying to trip me up here. The first hearing health organization to receive this accreditation. The other thing to know about Dr. Meyer is that if she loves doing what she does, but she also loves the parks more, and if she was ever offered the job to be a park ranger, we'd never see her again. So that's why I haven't told her about my cousin who works as a park ranger, and I'm not going to talk about him after. But next to her, we have Jen Kerfoot, Chief Experience Officer from Farmbox RX. There, she leads the strategic planning, design, and implementation of initiatives that drive member satisfaction and retention. Additionally, Jen spearheads the member insights function using qualitative and advanced analytic approaches to understand the gaps in care and unmet needs of populations. She's also a military veteran, so the first person I've been on stage with that could actually kill me. Jen brings leadership and vision to diverse audiences and offers a unique perspective within startups and high growth stage companies. And in a past life, she used to run star rating programs, so she really knows how to help plans and really make them shine. Lastly, next to me, I'm very excited to be with Dr. Nathan Estrada, VP of Clinical at Nimble. At Nimble, Nimble Science, he's an expert on older adult balance training and fall prevention. He's a physical therapist by training. He received his doctorate in physical therapy from the University of Colorado Boulder, and where he received the Hubert J. Levy Humanitarian Award. Professionally, he's worked in outpatient orthopedics, sports medicine, and home health, where he discovered a passion for empowering older adults to participate more fully in life. Right. And that's not usually what people learn there, so I'm really happy that that's what you did. He really believes that we've all bought into the lie that aging is less and that health decline is somehow a normal expectation. And so he's going to talk a little bit about how that's not the case, hopefully.
True.
But George, I want to start with you because you kind of sit at the top looking across the spectrum of what health consumers are looking for, what's making them choose one plan over another, and most importantly, why people change. So can you tell us a little bit about why people switch plans and how often are benefits the reason for it?
Sure thing, Max. At DEF Research, we study the health insurance consumer through all aspects of their care delivery to try to understand what motivates them, what keeps them loyal, things like that. And we conduct a shopping and switching survey every year, post-AEP, to try to understand why it is that so many consumers will look for new insurance or move. And ultimately, many times it is benefits, and it is supplemental benefits. We saw last year, if you think about the whole senior space and different segments of senior consumers, the least likely consumer to switch, to make a change for any reason, is your Med Sup consumer, right? A supplemental consumer, Med Sup consumer, They're content with their coverage. They're not looking to better their health insurance, but they might be looking to save some money. And that med sub consumer, about 7% of them make a change, but that's generally to save on premium. When you look at the MA consumer and the full pay MA consumer, meaning no LIS, not a D-SNP consumer, about 15% of them switch any given AEP. And benefits and supplemental benefits are the driver there. And then at the top of that pyramid, we would see the SNP consumer. Last year, about 30% of D-SNP consumers switched, and almost entirely that was due to supplemental benefits. The benefits themselves, yes, they are the shiny lures that get consumers to look to see if they can do better. It varies by group. When we look at the full pay Medicare Advantage consumer, the three benefit areas that actually led to switching: dental, number one. Number two, flex cards, greater flexibility with their supplemental benefits, and that's both purses and what's covered. And then number three, Part B give back benefits. Now, these aren't things necessarily that are going to make consumers be healthier, but when we look at what motivates folks to look for new coverage in the full pay MA, it is dental, number one, it's the flex card, which covers hearing, right, dental, vision, et cetera, and Part B give backs. When we focus on the D-SNP consumer, right, which is almost 6 million strong right now, we see for those folks, it's also flex card, right? And it's the overall allowance dollar amount that drives them. It isn't network, it isn't drug coverage, it isn't all those other things. And for the MA consumer, what we see for a voluntary switcher, more times than not, it is the benefits that they look for. And when you see commoditization in the MA space, everyone has zero. Tier one drugs are zero, tier two are around eight. The cost element is so close that a lot of times the differentiators are going to be those supplemental benefits. So it varies a little bit by consumer, but that is typically what drives a voluntary switcher during the AEP.
And I also know that you just wrapped up a dual eligible study. Is that right? Can you tell us a little bit about what causes them to switch?
For the D-SNP consumer, we focus on housing insecurity, food insecurity, transportation issues, and dental. Those four areas tend to dominate the elderly, low-income consumer. And, if you walk them out in these folks' shoes, obviously they have a tough lot in life, a very significant health issues, and you're living under 150% of the federal poverty level with no assets. The dental benefit is critical. Dental is critical for all seniors, but, 50% of D-SNP consumers have difficulty or pain eating. And 20% have active tooth pain any given day. That just means dental is constantly front of mind. But the interesting thing we saw this year was how the food benefit really took off. We saw in that study, any senior who in the last 12 months suffered from food insecurity, they were 60% more likely to switch carriers this past year. Really seeking out more value in a food benefit. And, you think about inflation and prices going up. The low-income senior is the most susceptible to the bad issues of inflation. And when you look at the fact that at-home food prices are rising at a greater rate than overall CPI and a greater rate than their Social Security cost of living increase, that food benefit was paramount. The other one that we saw in the D-SNP study we just published was the transportation element. And transportation has been a challenge for years, obviously, with dual consumers. But what was interesting to us is when there was a transportation benefit outside of medical or pharmacy, right? So everybody has a transportation benefit for medical pharmacy. When you had it where I could use this to go to the grocery store or to go to the park or to visit my family, that was also associated with people 60% more likely to switch carriers. And those were the two elements I saw in that D-SNP study that were striking. The food benefit's so critical. If you believe that we're in for more this fall with tough inflation and at-home food prices, it's going to be critical this year. And then the second thing was transportation outside of medical. Those were elements that caused the market to move last year.
Awesome. Thank you so much, George. I want to dive into one of the ones that you just talked about, the food benefit. We're lucky here to have Jen from Farmbox Rx. And the food benefit's a relatively new area. It's not one that really existed before. And I know that Farmbox Rx has been experiencing some rapid growth, you know, start launching last year with only two carriers and now having 102 contracts with 64 carriers. I got the number right? Yeah, there we go. So that's some crazy growth. Can you tell us a little bit about how, you know, Farmbox Rx has been able to do that?
Yeah, and thank you, George, for setting me up so well for my segment. So a little bit of a history lesson for those of you that might not know. So food and produce was brought in for Medicare Advantage beneficiaries to be able to have under the Chronic Act in 2019 for plan year 2020. And that came with two kind of challenges. One, how do plans market this? Because it comes under SSBCI, which is Special Supplemental Benefits for the Chronically Ill, or VBID, which comes from CMMI, the innovation arm of CMS. And so plans were like, great, we can offer this. And then if there are any brokers or FMOs in the room, it was very enticing to be sold. But how do you know as a plan, am I eligible to receive these benefits? Because it's not like hearing or dental where all your MA members are able to get that. And so one of the ways that we really partnered is, in my former life, you mentioned I used to run star ratings programs for MA plans, is that when, you know, a new startup's coming to plans, you want to sound like a health plan. And so speaking to a health plans within the confines of their goals, I did a little bit of motivational interviewing on plans, kind of like we do with our members. And so I talked to them about, you know, how can we do utilize a benefit for strategic growth or strategic retention, or shedding bad risk, increasing, you know, retention in good areas that you want to grow in. And like you mentioned, for those dual eligible members, how can you address those needs through food? Another way that we were able to really rapidly grow within various markets is not only bringing it to them in the bid as a supplemental benefit. I'm a real stickler on it that in the bid benefits, and then anything a member else gets, it's usually quality improvement programs or a case management intervention. And so we also differentiated our product where we can work within the bid, where a member gets a reoccurring delivery of goods to them, or as a quality improvement program where a plan can then use this delightful kind of box coming to the member's door to cross-pollinate their kind of messaging. When I was at a health plan, there's really three levers that I used to pull to communicate with members. One is cold calls. If you've ever got a call, or a loved one of you got a call during fourth quarter where they're like, hi, I know we haven't talked to you all year, but can you get your colonoscopy? And members are like, I hate that. And so how can we talk to members about, you know, diabetes, hypertension, colorectal cancer screening through this delightful kind of box? And so we do that through quality improvement programs year round. It's really for any startup, and we've heard various panels here at the conference speaking about these things. It's going to payers, speaking to payers and payer speak, and then creating a product that's going to members. So at any given time, you're marketing two different things at once.
Nice. So essentially, health plans were sending up boxes of food saying, hey, don't forget about your colonoscopy this year.
Essentially, but I like to say it's no pun intended, it's hiding the peas inside the mashed potatoes. Somebody told me it's the cheese on top of the broccoli, whatever food pun you want to use. But for example, at the end of last year, we'd sent hundreds of thousands of boxes, many to dual eligible members around the holiday time. You know, a lot of times we take for granted the holidays and, you know, being able to meet together and eat a meal as a family. And so we sent turkeys, chickens, vegetables, all sorts of stuff for these members to have, you know, a really nice holiday dinner. But we put also our health literacy, you know, material in the box. There's not a single box that we ship out that doesn't have that health literacy material in it to kind of guide them on that journey, those small things, those small steps where they can change that make a big impact. And we are able to put things like flu, like shots, like where to get them. And so while they're reading the recipes, they're seeing this as well. It's that kind of that art of inception.
Very clever. I love that.
Thank you.
So, Jen, while you are, you know, a kind of a brand new benefit, Carrie, you're here representing a very, not old benefit, but kind of standard benefit. You know, we're talking about hearing. So, you know, hearing has a decent amount of competition. Walking around the expo hall, I've seen at least a few different providers of hearing benefits. You know, given that, how do you differentiate? Like, what do you do differently from other benefit providers to win these contracts?
First of all, you don't have to have to be old. So, excellent question. One of the primary things that we're working really hard on is to make the member experience truly white glove, that concierge. I know we've all heard and talked about it, but within the hearing healthcare space, one of the really intriguing and, to my mind, upsetting issues is that health plans and a lot of medical providers, actually, Nathan and I were talking about this, are not aware of the massive incidence of hearing loss. So we know that over 40 million adults have hearing loss. 90% of all hearing loss can only be treated with hearing aids, but less than 35% of people who need hearing aids are wearing hearing aids. So we're working much more on loved your peas and the mashed potatoes, all right, is those things to encourage members to think of this as whole person health. So we're trying to educate our members, we're trying to educate our health plans, first of all, about the impact of very common health conditions on hearing. If you are diabetic, if you have sleep apnea, if you have cardiac disease, if you're a smoker, if you are obese, you are more likely to have hearing loss. So we wanted those patients, those members, to be aware that these health conditions predispose them to hearing loss. Create that awareness. We're doing that through member education. We're also pairing with our health plan partners. Our marketing team works with them to create really dedicated and targeted education for members. The other thing that we want people and health plans to be incredibly aware of is the coexisting conditions with hearing loss. So I'll leave the falls with injury to Nathan, but we know that hearing loss is a leading indicator of how likely a person is to fall. We know that anyone with hearing loss, even mild hearing loss, is 50%, two times more likely to develop depression than someone with normal hearing. And the one that strikes deeply into my heart and is the reason I'm wearing hearing aids right now is that even a mild hearing loss makes you three times as likely to develop dementia. If you have a severe hearing loss, you're five times more likely to develop dementia. When we're talking to our health plan partners, we can look at this two ways, right? We can first of all look at this as simply member education and making sure that we're addressing whole person health. If we want to get down to that granular level that our payers are really concerned about, is the bottom line is those conditions that are impacted by hearing loss. Dementia falls with injury, and depression are high cost health conditions. Unfortunately, the primary issue that we have with this motivational ambivalence, you said motivational interviewing. One of the things that Amplifon does very differently is our call center is designed very differently than a typical call center. Our call center, first of all, recognizes that many people who have hearing loss aren't going to call. A phone is very challenging to use if you have a hearing loss. So family members are going to call. We are HIPAA compliant for family members to be calling in. We've also trained our call center team that people with hearing loss are going to take more time. They're going to need things to be repeated. They might need things rephrased. And then the biggest one of all is nobody wants this service. Nobody wants those hearing aids. Nobody wants to admit, oh, you're old with this. And we have trained motivational interviewing within this. One of the real key components that we've created that has been really successful in a very short run so far is one thing that we have discovered from the Market Track 22 research. The two biggest indicators that someone will actually seek help for hearing loss, and it can take people up to 5 years from recognizing they have a hearing loss to actually seeking help, is a compelling hearing test. But going to the audiologist, going to the hearing instrument specialist is scary. You don't do that. I take a poll here. When was the last time any of you had your hearing tested in the last year? Raise your hand. Yeah, that's a stunning, did I get one? Okay, all right. This is standard healthcare for anyone over the age of 50. And the reason being is it's not fun and it's very anxiety provoking. The dentist, your tooth hurts, you're gonna go in, you're not gonna like it, but you know what to expect. Your glasses, no, you don't wanna hear that you need bifocals, but at least you get cute frames. Hearing loss is very different. So we give them a compelling hearing test. When hearing loss occurs, it occurs so gradually, most people aren't aware of the degree of loss. So we've created a little app. It takes about 5 minutes, uses a standard set of headphones, but the really, really big difference for us, any of you can Google right now and take an online test in about a minute and a half. Our test is actually followed by one of our trained care representatives. Help that member through, help them take the test, and then give them the options. Answer questions, give them the pass or fail test results, and then connect them to one of our providers. So that white glove service where we're actually treating that hearing loss member as special and different helps that better utilization of benefits. Hearing aids don't work if they're not on someone's head.
Makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
And I love the way that you describe that, a kind of white glove service. It's clear that you really think about, like, you really provide full hearing health benefits. From my understanding, that's not necessarily offered by many health plans. Mm-hmm. What they have is, like, not nearly full. Mm-hmm. Why not? Why are they reluctant to change and improve that?
Well, it's been something I've been digging into a little bit the last year, and I've learned a couple of things. One is that utilization of hearing benefits is actually very low, but health plans that I've talked to are like, well, we don't get any complaints. Well, that isn't a tremendously successful answer on that. So one of the things we've done to really motivate our health plans is to remind them that we're the hearing specialists. Hearing is rather complex. It involves a lot of things. In the worst possible cases, it involves a really, really high-tech device that needs a really well-trained professional to dispense. So we've created something called the Amplifon product line, and this is actually a white-label product that our providers can choose. It's no additional cost to any members, but what we've done is we're working to increase patient satisfaction with this. So once that member gets those hearing aids, they connect to their phone, which tends to be the most enticing thing for people, is your hearing aids can also be a Bluetooth headset. And now with that app, what we're actually doing is positive motivational intervention. So what we can do is on our dashboard, we can actually see how many hours a day that patient is wearing their hearing aids. And if we're seeing some criteria, less than 8 hours a day, or it's decreasing over the course of time, or they were fit with two hearing aids and are only wearing one, we have trained call center team that reach out and actually positively coach that member through, hey, you've got these devices, what do you think? Maybe how many hours a day do you think you're wearing them? Why don't you pop open your app and we can take a look at that? What would help you wear those more? So coming up underneath what our providers are already done, and then actually creating that additional positive coaching, we're demonstrating to our health plan is that we will be that hearing expert. You don't need to worry about that. We can guarantee you there'll be fewer patient complaints.
Makes sense. Thank you again, Carrie. Okay. So far we've heard from, you know, the overview of what patients want and why they change plans. We've heard from a brand new benefit, an established benefit, and now we're gonna talk to Nathan, because what you're doing is very unique in that you are working kind of in an established benefit space, but you're virtualizing it. So you're kind of changing the way it operates. Can you tell us a little bit, A, about what you do, but then also about what specific challenges? Did that make it easier to convince payers to go for it? Did that make it harder? Tell us more about working in that space.
Yeah, so as a physical therapist, one of the hard realities is people actually don't want to see you. That is not a badge of honor to go, I needed physical therapy, right? Just like in the hearing space. And so as a result of that, when you look at those motivational factors of no one attends, only 1 in 800 older adults in the United States find themselves in a balance class. I'll give $20 to anyone in this room who can sign up for a balance class in Las Vegas. I'll pay that all day long because you can't, right? And an older adult can't either because, you know, we're all older adults in training. And so ultimately, because of that, we had to figure out, well, what do the people actually want then? If they don't want PT, right? If they don't want someone telling them how to eat, but you can delight them instead, dang it, let's just make a game. Let's make a game that people like to play, because I don't know about you guys, but I can't get my grandparents off their phone anyway. That's a whole nother conversation, right? Creating a game experience, delighting someone and not telling them what they should do, but instead creating want, creating intention, creating self-efficacy and coping self-efficacy over time, what happens is you get engagement. So instead of 5% of a population going to PT, we get 1 in 3 of an eligibility file to actually participate in our program and to engage us. And so when you get 1 in 3, you know what you have? The ability to impact quality, the ability to impact savings. You can't do that when only 1 in 800 are doing something. So that's the problem that we went to solve. And I think what really brought us to that is the realization that very personally, if we raised our hand, how many of us have had a loved one fall? Right? We've had that. And we also see the consequences of that. We've seen that. It's a big problem, but we've created solutions that no one wants to do. Right? And about 92% of older adults won't leave their home for any wellness offering. If you're not doing stuff in the home, you're not doing things. And the people that are going to the gym are the people that don't need help anyway. They just got done with their yoga, they just did a 5K, and then they show up to the balance class. Congratulations on being the super ager. You're not falling. But the person who's terrified at home, who goes, maybe I'm not an exerciser, I can't do those things. Well, how about you just play the game instead? And if you happen to improve your balance, that's a win. And we feel like that's a pretty good strategy.
It sounds great. And when you talk to payers, particularly the first few, did they jump on board with that? Did they get that, or were they skeptical?
No, because they're all full of clinicians like me who go, it's my magical touch that heals people, right? It's providers, and providers like to think providers solve provider issues. And for a long time, balance has been a provider issue. And the reason why it had to be a provider, because as a physical therapist, you had to challenge the brain and the body to really improve balance. I don't know if you guys know that. Doing a balance exercise when you're all thinking about it, standing on one foot, going, Hercules, Hercules. That's not balance. That's executive function. The next time you stumble, you need your reflex to be available. And so because providers believed it was their purview, there was a lot of friction. Right? And so what we had to do is we really had to overcome that and go, well, guys, the reason why you learn that in medical school is because you went to medical school like I did before the smartphone was invented, right? 88% of older adults have a smartphone and they use it daily. When you learned about all the best practices, it was before all that existed. What if, put your whole bias aside here, what if the cognitive challenge could be deployed there instead of it being the obnoxious physical therapist who never shuts up and distracts you the whole time? And then suddenly we were able to show them that actually we're just replicating what is the clinical gold standard in a new tool that didn't exist. Let's all realize that we have a whole new world of interventional capability, but we got to use it and we got to stay out of our own way. So most of it was clinicians. The actuaries go, I'll do that all day long because they're getting the engagement, right? But the clinicians that show me the evidence. And we're like, well, so we did. We ran the world's largest fall prevention study, and now I don't get that question.
There you go. All right, so we have some audience questions. Don't forget, the QR code should be on the side. Feel free to send them in. The first one we have here asked about, you know, what the next benefit we should be on the lookout for. You know, prepaid shopping cards were last year, this year. You know, what's next year, and how can these benefits differentiate themselves? George, I feel like maybe you could talk a little bit about that, but then also the...
Sure, I'd say it's a little bit more of the same that we're seeing coming down the pipe. When it comes to new benefits to keep an eye on, we are hearing more and more about different purses and supplemental benefits and more about a gasoline purse to assist with kind of a broader transportation element. We did test, and it tested fairly well, a pet supply benefit for D-SNP consumers on the companion element. I would say those are two things that we're kind of seeing, I guess, maybe a little bit on the horizon for new benefits.
Pet supply, I like a lot. And I remember when we were talking before this, you mentioned that one of the big things that affects benefits and people switching is macroeconomic conditions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so, you just cleared out the audience by saying macroeconomics.
I know. essentially, the crazy times that we're in now, you know, we're in a post-pandemic, high inflationary recession. I didn't think those words could go together, but they do now. So can you tell us a little bit about how that factors into the benefits that the hot ones that will be next year and what people will be looking for?
Yeah, I'm not a macroeconomics expert, but if you listen to what you hear out of DC and Jerome Powell, basically what they've signaled is they're going to keep rates high through Q1 of 2024 because they expect inflation to be high through Q1 2024, which means inflation is going to be an issue we're going to have to deal with this AEP. And if we look at how inflation impacted last AEP, you know, one of the biggest things that we saw from the care perspective was just pushing forward and further with those Part B givebacks. I know we're all thrilled with those, right? There's a lot of value that goes in giving people money in their Social Security check for their health. But that did really well in a tight time. When food inflation is running ahead of CPI, that's where older, lower-income consumers struggle the most. And if you can give me a little bit of money to take off this edge with my rent going up or my utilities going up, that was a big deal. And, you know, 2022, we had just 12% of all plans in MA offer to get back. And that went to 17% last year. We have 9% of all MA beneficiaries receiving a give back. I think you're going to see more of that for this year, and I think that is definitely an inflationary play. I also think long-term, that's not the best value proposition that any health brand wants to be associated with. And I think there'll be a day of reckoning. You know, with that advance notice letter, I thought that day of reckoning was coming this year. It got a stay of execution. But I'll tell you, we're publishing a study on Thursday, you know, of the folks that have a Part B give back, and we asked them in a declining reimbursement environment, what's the one thing you don't want to give up? Is it your dental? Is it your vision? Is it your hearing? Is it your Part B give back? You know what it was, right? 45%, the last thing I want to see go is my give back. So I think it's a really bad spiral that the industry's gotten in, but that sold policies in a high inflationary environment, and I think it's going to sell policies this fall as well.
Great. That is unfortunate, but it is really interesting and makes a lot of sense in these times. It'll be interesting past Q1 2024. Hopefully when things settle down, what happens then, right? Do consumers start valuing those other benefits? Is it still the give back? It'll be quite interesting. A question that I have just in general for the panelists is, you know, the panel's all about utilization and outcomes, and outcomes can mean different things. So I'm curious how, you know, internally you measure success and how the payers measure success and how that's different and how you're able to kind of align that a little bit to work for both.
I'll take a crack at this one. So I like to think of it in terms of four quadrants, which is one is growth and retention. So what am I doing to delight members? And I can do that through surveying the members that we serve in every box that ships out. So I can look at NPS if members are satisfied, if they would refer this to a friend, and I can calculate on a standard RAF of one at a standard benchmark in membership, what does retained plan premium look like year over year? Another one that I can do is encouraging members to go get annual wellness visits, I'm increasing accuracy of risk adjustable visits. Another is obviously looking at those gaps in care, specifically around HEDIS measures, you know, with the star ratings changes, like you were talking about, we thought we were gonna get really bad in that advance notice and got that stay of execution. But looking at the changes in star ratings, it's about to be, one, we had this huge drop in star ratings, the great stars recession coming from the better of measures when we were looking at the plans that were utilizing that during COVID. And then we see the resurgence of HEDIS and five new measures that have been proposed, mainly around pharmacy and polypharm and opioids and benzos. But looking at, you know, simultaneously, how can I affect and fill those gaps? And also early identification of members who have, you know, any barriers in care and educating them on benefits and services that they didn't already know they had through health literacy in our boxes. You know, food is the core of what we do, but we really use that as a vehicle to improve quality health outcomes, and I tie it to that as well. Another one, obviously, is using this as a way in how we educate members. We had members say, you know, I switched my plan to be in this health plan because I thought I had a utility benefit under SSBCI, but come to find out that my power company doesn't accept this card, and now I'm really, really angry. And so we work with health plans to educate members through that AEP and OEP, because I'd rather have a member leave me. I use the analogy, it's like a first date, and then it went really badly, but we're stuck in this terrible marriage for a whole year. And you don't want that as a plan. And so how can I either educate members early on that this is might not be for you, and strategically get them to another health plan within the same shop, or get them to a different health plan that really is to the betterment of their health? And so that's kind of how we think of it in that four quadrant.
Amazing.
Yeah, I think we look at a lot of, we have one luxury, which is falls happen a lot. So there's a lot of value there, right? And so you look at, but they're not risk adjusted. And because falls aren't considered a chronic disease. So people that are fallers actually cost twice as much PMPM as someone who doesn't fall, and there's no revenue. So that's part of it. But what we found actually is just as impactful is we impact the entire HOS survey. And that's actually never been done before. I mean, you look at physical health, falls, you know, physical monitoring and mental health, we have outcomes across the continuum, and it took us, not us saying with the outcome, but our partner studying the outcome. And I think that's kind of a general trend between all of us. As much as I would love to say that everyone trusts what I say, they want to see it themselves, and everyone thinks they're unique, so they want to see it over and over again. There'll be a day where everyone in this room goes, we trust you, but that's not today. And so ultimately, we had to kind of grow through the outcomes and do individual studies with all of our partners to show that value. The sad reality is we have to then repeat that study with every partner. And so I'd love to see, you know, how we get past that as an industry of actually cross-pollinating ideas, because it shouldn't be an industry secret that things are working for older adults, because we all got into this to help older adults. We should be sharing that information.
I like that a lot.
And so that's one of the things we're working on with patient outcomes is we are doing a year-long patient satisfaction survey very much related to, and we have the ability, because as you stated, we're established, to be looking at some of our members who are using our additional care with the app, with the motivational interviewing, with the positive interventions, and then we can look at those without. So we have that ability. We just started it, launched it about 3 weeks ago.
Well, I was going to ask, can you share some data from that?
So we're looking at that, and which we think is going to really provide us some actual evidence-based information for our health plan partners as to why this is valuable. When I've gone to other conferences, the things that I hear from health plan providers, and I see somebody ask me about OTC hearing aids, so I'll add that in here too, is that they always want to know about how they can use that benefit to have a member engagement. I kept hearing very consistently in previous conferences that I was at is that their members are not, MA was ramping up hugely for a while, supplemental benefits were a great big deal, it was wonderful, it was this huge wave, and in the last year, this has fallen off greatly. How do we attract those members? And to my mind, how do you create that stickiness, right? So that stickiness for us is that constant reinforcement and positive support of that member. You've got that hearing aid. You can't get into your provider for 4 to 6 weeks, which is what's happening with all health plan providers. Don't worry about that because we're here for you right now. We can answer that question. We can answer it on the phone. We can do a virtual visit. We can text you. Maybe we can just direct you to our website for that. So when they have that support, when they're wearing those hearing aids and feeling better, hearing better, life is going better, they're going to remember that and they're going to have that additional stickiness with that health plan. All right. And then also that additional willingness to continue wearing that and that patient outcome. Regarding over-the-counter hearing aids, so over-the-counter hearing aids, frankly, in a room full of people who work in health insurance, came about because hearing aids weren't covered by health insurance. Hearing aids are expensive, and they weren't covered by health insurance. And so this was essentially an industry, the hearing aid manufacturer industry, push to make them more available to consumers. Because up until October of this year, you essentially needed a prescription and a licensed provider. I'll be very frank with you. What we're seeing initially for over-the-counter hearing aids is the utilization is extremely low. The return rate is extremely high. Because unlike your reading glasses, where you can kind of play around at Walmart for 5 minutes and figure out which ones will fit, that doesn't work that way with hearing loss. Hearing loss occurs very differently. It's a neural degradation, unlike eyes where you simply need to refract light. You're dealing with an impacted nervous system, and you need professional intervention. So how we're addressing this with our health plan partners is we're kind of splitting it into two parts. First and foremost, we're reminding them that we already have benefits with licensed credential providers that can provide the true technical care that these patients need and that they are going to get the best outcomes with that. If nothing else, having a licensed professional look in your ear to make sure it's okay to put a hearing aid in there and do a hearing test, and our health plans can do that. Also, we have the ability, because we have this huge spectrum of hearing aids, to fit with a licensed provider very close to OTC price points. At the same time, though, in the same breath, I wouldn't discount over-the-counter hearing aids. I think they're going to have this lovely little niche spot. Believe it or not, I'm looking out there. It's actually for people 55 and younger who don't want to be old and wear hearing aids, that we're finding that there is a little bit of traction there. And if this encourages people early in their middle age to seek that help, to provide that benefit of stimulating that auditory cortex and preventing depression, falls with injury and dementia, it's a good first step. So we are creating some products for our health plan partners who might want to use OTC products.
That's very interesting. My wife complains all the time that I don't hear her, so maybe they're being made for me.
I will tell you right now, we can only fix hearing, not listening.
Okay. I guess I'll have to relay that. One question that I have for all of you is, you know, what it takes to engage with a new payer. Like, how long is that process when you first engage? What does that initial contract look like? And how do you grow from there?
It's painful, right? I mean, you look at a selling cycle for Medicare and Medicare Advantage, it's, 14, 16 months at times. Luckily, I sound like you just need to join our team. It's such a struggle, but part of it is You look at, there's only certain times a year where people can make these type of decisions. So there's a cyclical nature of this where people are doing planned benefits or different things like that. But we also find that that land and expand, which I think most small companies like myself really go through, can be a challenge because that initial first purchaser in a company is really excited and they have that little cute little budget, all right, and they, that little group of people that they want to impact, but getting it to the broader scope takes bigger budgets, takes the clinical budget and doing things like that. And as a result of the lagging measures, they're still looking at research that was published 20 years ago. And as a result of that, jumping the gap from those early adopters in a plan to a full plan, you have to overcome the lack of their own understanding and their own kind of literature and outcomes. So we find that we start off, we run a pilot, and that pilot grows to another pilot, and then that group would love to pilot, and then pilot again, and then if they could pilot us to death, they would just be happy as could be. And ultimately, it's our job to actually impact more and more people, because that's the mission. So expanding, landing expands the primary strategy, but we do find there's some headwinds because unlocking that future budget requires information that takes 12 months to achieve.
So my team is in the room. Don't throw anything at me. I won't give away any secrets that you all have. But first, I totally hear what you say. And pilot, as a former person that held the budget at a health plan, I remember being like, no, you don't get any money. So I think one of the things is I don't like pilots because when I think of the word pilot, I think it was short and there's a small N. And it's really hard then to answer the payer's next question or what are your outcomes? And you only had a sample size of 400 members. And you're like, well, that's all you would give me for. I can't do this for free. So I think one of the ways that you can do it is really looking at the total sales cycle. So we have, again, the bid season, which runs, you know, January through April, because they have to have it locked in by June. If you're not in by April, I say don't go out. But then looking at other ways that you can really work within, especially Medicare Advantage as a quality improvement program under their administrative dollars and try and do pilots with the quality team specifically at large scale, either utilizing some upside risk or backing it into, you know, a really low gross margin with a little upside at the end based on star ratings. Adhere Health kind of grew their business utilizing that. Another one is kind of looking at how can I contract? You can go chopping branch by branch with regionals or small markets or go to the big payers and paper on a national MSA and then get a license to hunt throughout their markets. So taking a strategic approach year round, I was just talking to somebody about working within the model of care as a case management intervention, or even looking at kind of other partners to the MA payer, like ACO. ACO REACH is a really great area right now, specifically because it was built with health equity in mind. It replaced the former model, which really didn't hold them to any clinical outcomes and health equity. And this has a really great runway into MA because many are affiliated. So looking at different areas you can go in that don't have that tricky sales cycle is one of the approaches I think we took. But also not forgetting that, you know, Medicaid, many, many individuals are covered under Medicaid as opposed to Medicare Advantage. Looking at how you can really impact that and then expand to their D-SNP, especially as you see the migration from MMP to D-SNPs, getting rid of those lookalikes and creating multiple verticals to kind of hit throughout the entire year so you're not just stopping after bid season ends.
I feel like any startup should go to the video after this and just replay that over and over and over for getting into MA plans. A quick question to follow up on that. When you're able to get in to, you know, one of the verticals in the health plan, does that help at all in terms of like getting into the bid or moving into the other areas?
I'd say absolutely. Like so star ratings, and that's, I lean on that a lot because that's my background coming from a payer side, is that it's, I say the culmination of your star rating is really the ability of health plans departments to come together and not operate in silos. There's not a single part of your star rating that one team holds. And actually, your stars team is really just aggregating everything and getting everyone to go in one direction, when in reality, it's a bunch of departments working together. And so the PharmBox RX product, we really designed it intentionally to break down silos inside a health plan, because I know that every health plan has some kind of silo. And so our product, it touches risk, it touches member experience, it touches, you know, quality and product. And so how can I, if I get in with one, they're like, oh, this makes a lot of sense. Let me grab my quality friend, or I just say, I'm going to invite your quality team to the table. And that way, if a product team is saying, no, Jen, it doesn't work for us right now to go into our bid, I'm like, okay, well, let's try this out. Like, try before you buy. Let's do this year as a quality improvement program. And then we'll be primed for going into the bid. We'll already socialize it to your members. I like to leverage Q4 because a handful of different things happened during that time. And then you're able to not only make better relationships within health plans where you're truly a partner. I had a health plan the other day say, we like working with you because you work with us, not for us. How can you be a collaborative partner to these plans in and out of the actual selling cycle of the bid?
Makes sense. Carrie, how do you guys get into Medicare plans and what's that initial engagement look like?
Well, for us, again, because you stated we're certainly not a startup, we're established. What we tend to do is remind everybody that we can be plug and play. We have done this a long time and we are very, very good at it. And we have, and it, basically, if you want it, we can build it, right? So we can, and one of the things with Amplifon is we are a global company and we are not owned by a hearing aid manufacturer. Many TPAs are, we are not. And that allows us to have access to a full formulary across all manufacturers and all technology tiers. So we can build something big, huge, and rich. We can build something very narrow and economy based. We've also got everything. I like your silos analogy. We have all sorts of lanes on this. If you need a marketing program, if you need member education, you can use and you should use our call centers. We can do the billing and claims. We are kind of a one-stop shop for all of that. We have everything fully digital. We have a 5,600 provider network already in play. So we're incredibly easy to work with because we truly are the experts and know what we're doing. So that's what we bring to the table for payers.
And when a payer first mm-hmm. engages with you, do they just roll you out generally to their entire population right away?
I think that the answer is yes, no, maybe.
Okay.
All right. So yes, we have literally everything from work comp. We have commercial plans. We have Medicare Advantage. We have supplemental benefits. We even do have a couple of the Medicaid programs, kind of really narrow and small. So yep. So pretty much everything. But yeah, I think a lot of times it does tend to be, we'll give you this segment of our population. Show us what you can do, which is fine. We're not in the position of needing to run pilots at this time. Our outcomes are really well established. And so we tend to do more of, it tends to be more on that utilization ops side. How can you make it easy? How can we not hear those member complaints? How can we make sure that the call center actually knows what they're saying? Well, you use ours. We have that built.
Makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. George, we had a quick question from the audience about fitness and gym benefits. You know, in the studies that you've done, you know, what have you seen in terms of the value of the gym benefits and getting people to switch plans?
Typically, well, what I'd say is a gym benefit is usually not something that gets someone to switch a plan. But when you think about consumers who are new to Medicare, they're aging in for the first time, it's kind of a table stakes. Just like we were talking about, you know, I don't want to be feel old with a hearing aid, right? When people are moving off a commercial group or an ACA plan into Medicare for the first time, well, now I'm 65, now it's Social Security, now it's Medicare, and I want to see a plan that looks like me, and I want to think about my retirement as active. And so we see high consideration of a good gym benefit as people are aging in, but it's really not going to be something that's going to draw me to switch from one plan to another once I'm already in Medicare.
Makes a lot of sense.
And then Max, quickly, I'd be remiss if I didn't say this. A couple years ago, I was consulting with a health plan and they were debating on their gym benefit, just like you were saying. And so we ended up pulling the members because there was abnormally high utilization for silver sneakers. And I'm like, I've never seen it this high. There's something weird about this. And when we pulled the members, what we realized is like members were going to the gym to take a shower. And because they couldn't afford their utilities. So a lot of times when you see utilization, because our panel, I know we didn't talk a whole lot on utilization, is when you see high utilization, just because you see smoke doesn't mean there's fire, doesn't mean you have the hottest benefit, that they might be utilizing it for a different intended purpose, and to make sure that even when you're seeing those high data points, to really be digging into why you're seeing it and what's driving them to use it.
That is so interesting, and I would never have guessed. That's wild. So we're almost out of time here. Thank you again, all of you, for joining. And this has been really, really interesting. Any last words? And if people want to follow up, payers, whomever, how's the best way they can do that?
I think my only thing is solving big problems really matters. I mean, food insecurity and hearing and people's mobility. We got to get out of this mentality that we're solving these upper tier things like, hey, how do I get a flu shot? These people have real needs. Let's meet these global big needs together. If you want to contact us, we're at nimblescience.com. You can always look at us there. But we're just passionate advocates for taking care of the big problems of aging, I think, like everyone on the panel.
You can find me on LinkedIn. You can also find my amazing colleagues and myself. We have a booth here today, or find us at farmboxrx.com.
And it's amplifon.com, and we also do have a booth in the exhibit hall. Mm-hmm.
DeafResearch.com, we have a booth, LinkedIn as well.
Perfect. Thank you again, panelists. Can we please give them a round of applause? Mm-hmm.